Welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Dr. Hani Mathiani. I am an assistant professor in criminology working with Lok Nayak Jai Prakash Narayan, National Institute of Criminology and Forensic Science, Delhi. Today's topic of learning is the importance of feminist and critical victimology and the development of victim movement and advocacy. The objectives for the said learning are, first, to acquaint the learners about the feminist and the critical perspective of the victimology. Second, to get an insight into the developments of victim status in India. Third, to understand how certain legal enactments and judicial pronouncements helping the victim in improving their status. Let's start with the concept of feminism. Since centuries, the women are directed towards varied form of discrimination and violence. The feminist movement alerted us towards the apathies of women and made us realize that the discrimination and violence is gender specific and deeply rooted in the patriarchal society. The feminism aims to eliminate all forms of gender inequality. The goal is not to push men out, but to pull women in. It is basically a set of theories about women's oppression, which ultimately builds a plan to change the condition of women worldwide. The history of feminism can be divided into three waves. The first wave, that is 19th and the early 20th century, focused on the promotion of equal contract and property rights for women and opposed chattel marriage and the ownership of married women by their husbands. The second wave, that is 1960s, 70s and 80s, was concerned with the ending discrimination of women in cultural and political aspects. The second wave, feminist linked with the cultural and political inequalities women were facing with discrimination and encouraged women to understand aspects of their personal lives as deeply politicized and as reflecting the sexist power structures. The third wave, that is from 1990s to present, aroused as a response to the failure of second wave. It challenged the definition of femininity given by the second wave, as it was only emphasizing more on the experiences of upper middle class women. A post-structuralist interpretation of gender and sexuality is centered to the ideology of third wave. Now let's talk about different feministic concepts one by one. Gender reform feminism. The feminism of 1960s and 70s comprised of liberal feminism, Marxist feminism and development feminism. Liberal feminism expressed that women are discriminated on the basis of their sex. They are denied access to the same political, financial, career and personal opportunities as men. They claim that women and men are not different, as gender differences are not based in biology, and as claimed, if they are not different, then they should not be treated differently under all the aspects of life as well as law. They should enjoy all the rights, educational and work opportunities which men are also enjoying. Hence, liberal feminists focused on gendered job markets and inequitable wage scales. They used civil rights movements and anti-discrimination legislation to fight against the inequality, especially in job markets. They addressed the problem of gender and ethnic imbalance in workplaces and hence encouraged men to train for nursing, teaching, and secretary jobs, and train women for engineering, construction, and police work. With the creation of diversified pool of qualified candidates, employers can be legally mandated to hire different workers to achieve a balance in the workforce and to pay them equal wages and chances to advance in their careers. The main contribution of liberal feminism was to prove that even if women are different from men, they are not inferior. Marxist feminism put housewives into the structure of capitalism. Prior to that, as per Marxist ideology, married women in capitalistic society they were not allowed to own property in their name. And even if they are earning something, their wages or profits from businesses belong to their husbands only. Marx only recognized females as wives of workers and capitalists who work at home, and they have no place in Marx's analysis of capitalism. As per Marxist feminism, housewives are vital to capitalism because their unpaid work at home maintains bosses and workers. Also, if husband is facing a hard time, then his wife can do some work in the home, such as dressmaking, to earn some extra amount of money, or can take up a part-time job as well. The housewife labor, paid or unpaid, are for her family. Marxist feminism severely criticizes family as a source of women's exploitation. Development feminism showed that women are paid less than men workers in developing countries. They made an important theoretical construct which says that women's status can be equated with control of economic resources. Society where the women control significant economic resources enjoys a high status, and societies with patriarchal family structures, that is, men holds all economic resources, women have a low value. Development feminism addressed political issues of women's rights versus national and cultural traditions. Even the UN conference condemned few cultural practices which are oppressive to women, such as infanticide, dowry, child marriage, and female genital mutilation, etc. Few governments agreed to abolish these practices, but it was very difficult to get away with these practices as they were integral part of their cultural and tribal traditions, and giving them up could be seen as following the Western ideas. Hence, development feminists found this difficult to get resolved. Development feminists had to work in a dilemma where on one hand they had to work for women's education and better health care, and on the other hand, they should not interfere with traditional cultural practices that are equally harmful to the girls. Then comes the gender-resistant feminism. After reform comes resistant. Till 1970s, women had already entered into all the workplaces where men used to reign. But gradually, they became victim of the dissemination from bosses and colleagues at work and husbands and boyfriends at home. Out of this awareness evolved the gender-resistant feminism, which was comprised of radical feminism, lesbian feminism, psychoanalytical feminism, and standpoint feminism. Radical feminism, based on a theory of gender inequality that went beyond discrimination to oppression. Radical feminists see male power and privileges as the root cause of women's oppression and exploitation. Patriarchy is the watchword, and radical feminist argues that it is very hard to get away with patriarchal system as its root, which explains that women are different and inferior, is deeply embedded in the conscience of men. As per radical feminism, patriarchy can best be resisted by forming women-only spaces where women can think and act and create an atmosphere free of constant sexist put-downs, sexual harassment, and the threat of rape and violence. Radical feminist takes all the male-dominated characteristics, that is, aggressiveness, coolness, objectivity, and competitiveness, and blames them for war, poverty, rape, battering, and child abuse too. On the other hand, it praises women characteristics, that is, feed and nurture, cooperation, reciprocation, and attend to bodies, minds, and psyches. Radical feminist also talks about the potential of men to use physical violence against women, including rape and murder. The commercial side of this women hating is the way women are projected as sex objects in mass media and pornography, and exploited in prostitution too. Lesbian feminism is a way forward for the radical feminist pessimistic view of men. As per the lesbian feminist, if heterosexual relationship are exploitative in nature, then why bother with men at all? Lesbian feminism favors women to women relationship for sexual love as well as for intellectual companionship and emotional support, because women are more loving, nurturing and understanding in nature. Psychoanalytic feminism is based on the feminist rereadings of Freud's theory of personality development, which revolves around Oedipus complex. As per psychoanalytic feminist, the source of men's domination of women is men's unconscious two-sided need for women's emotionality and rejection of them as potential castrators. Boys as well as girls bond with the mother, but boys had to separate and identify with their fathers to establish masculinity, and in turn they develop strong ego boundaries. However, on the other hand, girls continue to identify with mothers and hence grew up with feudic ego boundaries, which makes them sensitive and emotional. Hence, to stop their production of gendered personality structures, the psychoanalytic feminism recommended shared parenting. Standpoint feminism is the convergence of all the feminist theories. Standpoint feminist argued that women are physical and social reproducers of children, hence are grounded in material reality, which men aren't. Women are responsible for everyday work even if they are educated. While educated, men concentrate on intellectual activities only. As per the ideology of standpoint feminism, women can produce knowledge which is more meaningful for everyday life because of the close connectivity with the bodies and the emotions. Then comes the gender revolution feminism. After resistance comes the revolution. In 1980s and 1990s, the newly emerged feminist theories questioned the dominant social order about its clearness of hierarchies. These theories analyzed how mass media and other cultural productions justify and normalize inequality and practices leading to inequality. It consisted of multi-ethnic feminism, men's feminism, social construction feminism, and postmodern feminism. All these feminism had the revolutionary potential of destabilizing the structures and values of social order. Multi-ethnic feminism believes that no one aspect of inequality, that is gender, is more important than others, like life ethnicity, religion, and social order. All these inequalities are a part of hierarchical stratification system in which upper class suppresses lower class and people with highest ethnic origin suppresses people lower in ethnic order. According to multi-ethnic ideology, a women's point of view is not enough to understand the prevalent inequalities. Hence, it is better to include the experiences of women and men of different ethnic and religious groups, keeping in mind the social and economic conditions of all. Men's feminism are those feminist theories which studied men and masculinity, that is women in relationship with men. This feminism treats men as well as women as a gender and scrutinizes masculinity as well as femininity. According to men's feminism, neither men nor women can be studied separately. The questions of gender inequality involves a relationship of haves and have-nots, and of dominance and of subordination. Social construction feminism sees gender as a society-wide institution which determines the distribution of power, privileges, and economic resources. As per the ideology, women and men are socially differentiated in order to justify treating them unequally, and because of this, so many people start believing that gendering is biological and therefore natural. The social processes which encourages gender differences are gendered division of labor at home, which allocates childcare and housework to women, and gender typing of occupation so that men and women don't do the same kind of work. postmodern feminism talks about the cultural representations such as movies, videos, TV, music, advertisement, which clearly and subliminally tells us something about female and male bodies, their sexual desires, their gender roles, and what they are supposed to play. All these discourses influence the way we think, we work, or the way we should be in our lives. After feminist perspective comes the critical victimology. The people who propagated the idea of critical victimology maintain that victimology fails to question the basic foundations of what is crime and ignored the question why certain acts are sanctioned, as defined by Mobby and Walklet in the year 1994. Critical victimology is an attempt to examine the wider social context in which some versions of victimology have become more dominant than others, and also to understand how these versions of victimology are interweaving with questions of policy response and service delivery to victims of crime. Therefore, the focus of critical victimology is the issue why certain actions are defined as criminal. Mobby and Walklet pointed out clearly that there are many crimes in society which are committed by powerful and wealthy and are not subjected to any criminal code. Some scholars have given the example of genocide, war crimes, political campaign, law violations, investment and consumer frauds, rape as a weapon of war, abuse of power, and many more. The general victimology never discusses about the victims who fall prey to these type of crimes. Now let's discuss about the development of victim movement and victim advocacy. The second half of this lecture will be emphasizing on how the status of victim in specialized cases in India has changed because of certain movements. See, in any criminal situation exist victim and accused both. While talking about reform-led movements, considerable attention was given to the rights of the accused, while victim's empathy was totally neglected. Recognizing that the rights of the victims had not been adequately addressed, the General Assembly of United Nations adopted the Declaration of Basic Principles of Justice for Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power, which is also known as Victims' Declaration, in the year 1985. The document sets a minimum standard for the treatment of crime victims. It was considered as the Magna Carta of the international victims movement. In India too, unlike the accused, the victims have virtually no rights in criminal proceedings. The accused's rights supersede the victim's rights. Victims has to suffer injustice silently when the state agencies fail to prosecute the offender. However, in India, there has been no special movement related to the victims, but certain judicial pronouncements based on judicial activism or mass appeal led to the improvement in the conditions of the victims of crime. Few of such movements based on judicial responses are as follows. Let's start with Vishakha guidelines first. Supreme Court in Vishakha versus Rajasthan provided a landmark judgment on sexual harassment against women and laid down number of guidelines to fill the gaps. In the said case, the victim was gang-raped by upper caste individuals of Bhateri village in Rajasthan. She was prevented by police and medical personnel to register their case and provide evidence. Hence, social activists and NGOs brought a writ petition seeking legal redress for the victimization she suffered while working with an organization for the cause of child marriage. The Supreme Court relied on CEDAW, which is Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, recognized sexual harassment of women at workplace and outlined the guidelines to prevent and redress complaints of such crimes. Some of the guidelines are: it is the duty of employer to prevent the commission of sexual harassment acts. The court defines sexual harassment, which includes physical contact, advances, demand, request for sexual favors, and many more. Guidelines which is to be followed by all the employers, public or private, for taking preventive steps. and what are the types of criminal proceedings required for the offence, it is also mentioned in the guidelines. What disciplinary action can be taken against the offender, that is also clearly mentioned in the guidelines. The guidelines also suggested a proper complaint mechanism and the establishment of complaint committee in every office. They have also mentioned about the creation of awareness among female employees too. The guidelines were provided in the year 1997, and after 16 years, the need of the society actually materialized into the act titled as the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplaces, Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013. Now let's talk about Best Bakery case. This case illustrates the predominant need to institutionalize the victims' and witnesses' rights as well as the protection within the Indian legal system in order to serve the justice. In this case, the Fast Track Court as well as the High Court of Gujarat acquitted all the 21 individuals charged with the murder of 14 people during the riots in Vadodara because maximum witnesses, including the main witness, that is Zahira Sheikh, turned hostile. The public prosecutor, even after reasonable suspicion that the witnesses are being threatened, didn't take any step for witnesses' protection. Afterward, the main witness, Zahira, pleaded to the Supreme Court of India for the retrial of case outside Gujarat as she was intimidated for not telling the truth. The Supreme Court ordered the retrial and reinvestigation of the case in Maharashtra, which ultimately contributed to life sentence for four accused. Now let's talk about Nirbhaya case, one of the most highlighted and brutal rapes. 16/12 was a case in which public furor led to the drastic changes in the major laws related to rape in India. In this case, a girl who was a physiotherapy intern was beaten and gang raped in Delhi. She succumbed to her injuries 13 days later despite receiving the best medical treatment in India as well as in Singapore. Due to huge public protest, a judicial inquiry committee was set up, headed by a former judge of Supreme Court, to suggest amendments in the criminal law for stern action in sexual assault cases. The result was the Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013. The highlight of this act was the change in the age-old definition of rape under IPC, which now covers penetration of any object or any part of the body to any extent into the vagina, mouth, urethra or anus. Also, a new subsection, that is 376A, has been added, which states that if a person committing the offence of sexual assault inflicts an injury which causes the death of the person or causes the person to be in a persistent vegetative state, shall be punished with rigorous imprisonment for a term not less than 20 years, which may extend to life imprisonment or death. The changes have been introduced in Criminal Procedure Code and Evidence Act too, like the process of recording the victim's statement has been made more victim-friendly and easy. The two critical changes are character of the victim is now irrelevant and presumption of no consent where sexual intercourse is proved and victim states that she didn't consent. Few new offences have also been added in Indian Penal Code under amendments 326A, that is acid attack, 326B, attempt to acid attack, 354A, sexual harassment, 354B, act with intent to disrobe a woman, 354C, voyeurism, and 354D, stalking. In addition to that, Juvenile Justice Act also attracted major amendments, out of which the most prominent one is the reduction in the age of juvenile. As per the amendment, now the juvenile aged between 16 to 18 years of age to be tried as adults for heinous offences if Juvenile Justice Board decides. Now let's talk about Sati, the legal purview of Sati in India. Sati Pratha has been a shameful social evil and an age-old practice in Indian society. The widows were burned with their consent or most of the times forcefully by in-laws after the death of her husband. as far as banning this evil practice, it was a very tough task as it had religious sanctions attached to it. Rulers like Akbar tried to restrict it but failed. Even Britishers took few steps in 1813 in the form of issuing the circular which prohibited the burning of women in all cases where the widow was below 16 years of age or pregnant or intoxicated. But these measures proved unsuccessful. The real change came during the time of Governor General Lord Williams Bentinck, when he tried to tackle several social problems prevailing in India, including the Sati Pratha. Many educated Indians also supported the cause, and the prominent among them was Raja Ram Mohan Roy. Due to his great efforts and work through pamphlets and publication and newspaper reports, the conscience of masses was awakened. Therefore, in December 1829, Regulation No. 17 was issued declaring the practice of sati or burning alive of widows illegal and punishable by criminal courts. Now let's talk about legal acceptance of live-in relationships in India. Marriage in India is considered as a sacred bond and a pass for cohabitation. With the change in society and human psychology, the concept of marriage has evolved and taken the shape of live-in relationship, which is a more liberal manner of two people cohabit outside the marriage without any legal obligations towards each other. Such relationships in India are taboo because of the unclear legal status. It attracts the exploitation of females too. In order to deal with this social issue, the Indian government amended Domestic Violence Act 2005, which now considers live-in relationship at par with marital relationships. The victims can take shelter under this act in case of any abuse. Few landmark judgments I would like to highlight here in this case. In Badri Prasad versus Deputy Director of Consolidation and others in the year 1978 was the first case in which the Supreme Court recognized live-in relationship and interpreted as a valid marriage. The court gave legal validity to a 50-year-old live-in relationship of a couple. In Tulsa and others versus Durgatia and others 2008, the Supreme Court gave legal status to the children born from live-in relationships. In D. Velusani versus D. Patyachamal 2010, the prerequisites for the live-in relationship were mentioned. It provided that couple must act as spouses in front of society, must be in legal age to marry, and must have voluntarily cohabited for a significant period of time. The court held that not all relationships will amount to relationship in the nature of marriage and get the benefit of Domestic Violence Act. Now let's talk about victim compensation to the rape victims in India. The Supreme Court of India, under the case Delhi Domestic Working Women's Forum versus Union of India and others, writ petition has directed National Commission for Women to evolve a scheme to wipe out the tears of rape victims in India. Hence, National Commission for Women has proposed a Criminal Injuries Compensation Board for the payment of compensation to victims of rape, as besides mental trauma, they also suffer from financial loss and in some cases they are too traumatized to continue in employment. The Supreme Court also further directed that compensation shall be awarded by court on conviction of offender and by Criminal Injuries Compensation Board whether or not conviction has been taken place in the case. To conclude the entire episode, I would like to say that the advent of victimology as a separate subject gave special emphasis on the study of victims in addition to the criminals. To be more specific, the feminist victimology highlighted the apathy of women as a victim, and critical victimology questions the policy response and service delivery to the victims of crime. Still in India, there is no separate law for crime victims and they continue to suffer in the passage of delivery of justice. But there are certain enactments passed by parliament and judicial pronouncements which have a significant bearing on preventing victimization of vulnerable sections of population such as women, children and elders too. Few of them were discussed during the lecture in order to understand how victim movement and advocacy paving the way towards the recognition of victims' pain in the society. Thank you very much.